So this is the second half of the panel, contributions from Africa. And we will be, just have one speaker in the second half. Our speaker is, Dr. Lamin Sanneh. He was born in La Gambia and descended from an ancient royal family. He was naturalized U.S. citizen and was educated in four continents. He earned degrees in history and Islamic studies and has taught in several universities, including the University of Ghana, the University of Aberdeen, and Harvard University, before coming to Yale University in 1989 as the D. Willis James Professor of World Christianity and of History. He is a life member of Clare Hall, Cambridge University, and an honorary research professor at the School of Oriental and African Studies in the University of London. He's the recipient of honorary doctorates from the University of Edinburgh, Liverpool Hope University. He has served several times as chair of Yale's Council on African Studies, editor at large of Ecumenical Weekly, of the Ecumenical Weekly, the Christian Century, and a contributing editor to International Bulletin of Missionary Research. And he has served as on the editorial board of several academic journals and encyclopedia. He is the author of over 100 articles on religion and historical subjects, and of several books. Most recently, he has published Abolitionists Abroad, American Blacks, and the Making of Modern West Africa, Faith and Power, Christianity and Islam in Secular Britain, and Whose Religion is Christianity? The Gospel Between the West. He was appointed by Pope John Paul II to the Pontifical Commission of the Historical Sciences, and by Pope Benedict to the Pontifical Commission on Religious Relations with Muslims. He has received an award as the John W. Klug Chair in the Cultures and Societies of the South and by the Library of Congress. For his academic work, he has received Senegal's highest national honor and is a recipient of an honorary doctorate from University of Edinburgh, Scotland. Please join me in welcoming Professor Sanneh.
Thank you very much for your kind introduction, and also thank you very much to Professor Cole and to the members of the International Institute and others involved in Middle Eastern studies and study of Islam. This is not my first time. I hope you can hear me, and I hope I'm audible. Yeah, I've been to conferences where speakers tend to run away from the microphone. this is not my first time to the International Institute. several years ago, I was invited by the then director, Michael Kennedy, and his colleague to do a summer seminar here at Michigan. It was a wonderful seminar. Michael, if you know him, is one of the most lively of intellectuals. And that summer was a high point, really, of intellectual energy and excitement. Michael, although I haven't seen him very much since he moved closer to us at Brown University, has remained a dear friend. I have the highest respect for Michael. I'm honored to be included in this conference. My work has been mostly focused on the implications of the Western missionary movement around the world, in particular the role of language and culture, the fact that in Bible translation, missionaries adopted the vernacular language as the language of scripture, of religion, of worship, and prayer. And as the historian that I am very interested in what the cultural and historical consequences of these projects, linguistic projects. Many of these missionaries, of course, became really the founders of comparative linguistics in the West and the founders of cultural anthropology at a time when academic institutions did not have departments of cultural anthropology. So that's really what fascinated me from an intellectual point of view. But I also began my own work in Islam in the Middle East, where I was a student at the American University of Beirut, and I had wonderful professors there, teachers. I returned recently to the American University of Beirut. It was a rather emotional return for me. I made so many wonderful friends. It was a great time before the Civil War. Much of that tradition is under tremendous strain and stress from the refugee influx from Syria and elsewhere. Lebanon has a relatively small population, and they have a refugee migrant population of 1.6 million. It makes me embarrassed as an American that we quarrel so much among ourselves about whether we should admit 10,000 in a country this size, my goodness. And also refugees fleeing wars we started, we initiated in the Middle East is not right. My presentation this afternoon, and I'm told I'm under very strict time constraints, and I'll try and keep to that, is to really look at jihad and civil society. That's a very telegraphic way of stating both a subject and an argument I want to make. The subject is really warfare and civil society. The argument I want to make is a rather fundamental argument that although in the Islamic tradition there is no separation of church and state, I argue there is unquestionably a distinction in Islamic sources on the distinction between religion and politics. And that the Quran talks a great deal about the Muslim community in the way that the Prophet established this in Medina in the form of the Ummah, but actually very little about the Caliphate. There is a reference to the Caliph, the Khalifa, in the Quran, but it's in terms of stewardship of creation. It's a kind of moral responsibility. And this argument is pretty fundamental to my exposition of jihad or warfare in Islam. I want to summarize my paper, not read all of it, in this way. I want to suggest that jihad has always been problematic in African Islam. But historians who have worked in African Islam, West African Islam in particular, have begun with the jihad hypothesis as the explanatory principle for the spread and expansion of Islam in West Africa. The event historians have focused on has been the Almoravid invasion of Ghana and the conversion of Ghana by the Almoravids to Islam. When I've looked at the historical sources, the first person to actually challenge me on this jihad hypothesis for the spread of Islam in West Africa was a Francophone scholar in Paris, whom I met when I was doing research there, Ibrahim Kake. And he said, you know, the oral traditions that we have do not support an Almoravid conversion of Ghana. So he sent me a draft of his article when I returned to London, and we followed up, and I introduced the idea to Humphrey Fisher, and Fisher and others have published articles in various sources challenging the Almoravid hypothesis. More recently, in my book, Beyond Jihad, published a few months ago by Oxford University Press, I returned to the issue in terms of the pacifist tradition in African Islam, West African Islam. That's the subtitle of the book. By the way, I was in the Vatican last month, and I presented Pope Francis with a copy of the book. and he took it, and he said, I'll keep this, and I'll read it. So that's very It's not usually the way you publish books, you know. Give one to the Pope. I return to the argument in this form, that the peaceful expansion of Islam in Africa occurred particularly strongly in the context of the Mali Empire, and that the Emperor of Mali, Mansa Musa, was extremely wealthy, the most powerful man in West Africa, went on pilgrimage to Mecca in 1324. Contemporary Arab writers who met him there were very impressed by his learning, by his devotion to Islam. They called him mutadayyanan, as to say, you know, devoted to Islam, ikhlas in a way. And they also commented on his tremendous wealth. He took so much gold to Cairo that it caused an inflation in Cairo, which Ibn Khaldun, writing nearly half a century later, said the effects of Mansa Musa's generosity in Cairo were still evident in his day. Mansa Musa never embarked on jihad once at all in Mali, in the Empire of Mali. I have in my book, I don't have it available to show on the screen, the approximate boundaries of the Empire of Mali, really stretching from the Sahel, upper Volta, Burkina Faso, right across to Senegal. It was a huge empire, very impressive, very powerful, but it was not built on jihad. And Mali was in regular contact with North African kingdoms and North African states, with Morocco, with Tunisia, with Algeria, and also with Egypt in Cairo. And the historian who gave the most credible earliest history of Mali was actually a Spanish Andalusian scholar based in Cordoba, Al-Bakri, Kitab al-Masalik wal-Mamalik. And his book, The Book of Roots and Kingdoms, introduces the two themes for the spread and expansion of Islam in West Africa. Roots meaning trans-Saharan trade routes, caravan routes, kingdoms meaning organized political societies and institutions into which Islam arrived. Those two mechanisms, trans-Saharan trade routes, the use of trade therefore, and trading patterns, and exchange and bargain, and organized political life and institutions in West Africa, account, according to Al-Bakri, for the spread and expansion of Islam in West Africa. Al-Bakri wrote a great deal about the Almoravids as well. He was rather stringent. But he never once proposed that the Almoravids conquered any part of black West Africa. Nowhere. The first person to really stress the Almoravid conquest of West Africa, of Ghana, was 300 years after the event, Ibn Khaldun in Kitab al-Ibar. But even Ibn Khaldun never said explicitly that the Almoravids conquered Ghana. He just merely said, well, their influence extended over the blacks, they imposed tribute on some of these communities, etc., the communities that did not accept Islam, which I think suggests that jihad was not undertaken, and if it was, it was pretty ineffective. Ahmed Baba of Timbuktu, the most illustrious, surely, of the great divines of Timbuktu, in the 17th century, challenged the Almoravid thesis and said, actually, it can be traced to an anonymous Qadi, a magistrate, who suggested it without any backing, without any support for it. And Ahmed Baba said, I therefore do not know anyone who can be relied on who supports the idea that people in West Africa converted to Islam under force. But how did jihad come to dominate so much of our scholarship? All the standard accounts of the spread of Islam in West Africa assume this Almoravid hypothesis, and there is not a shred of evidence for it. And as an historian, I reflect on this quite a bit, because I want to say what passes for history often is really a matter of perception. There are biases that historians cannot avoid. And our ideas, the ideas we propound, amplify, they get sort of, if you like, really exaggerated in the milieu in which those ideas are received. One of those milieus, of course, is post 9/11, the West, which has approached Islam as a problem of security. So the securitization of Islam has completely dominated scholarship in the United States since 9/11. It's quite extraordinary. I'm aware of this. But as an historian, I want to be faithful to the record in the way that actually Muslim scholars themselves want to be faithful to the record. Al-Bakri is an outstanding example of a Muslim scholar who did not indulge in fantasy and bias and polemics and prejudice, but tried to keep as much as possible to the facts of the case. It's a great model for us even today, nearly 1,000 years after Al-Bakri, to try to imitate. But we are dominated by the political environment in which we work as scholars. I hope that historians are able to take some distance from this. Ibn Khaldun himself says that historians can make two fundamental assumptions about the nature of history. First is that all human societies and communities have undergone change, even revolutions. And change, Ibn Khaldun argues, is a function of time. If you didn't have change, you can't really account for time. The second assumption, he says, we can make is that the past has an integrity of its own. It is the danger of historians to interpret the past then in light of what they know around them today. And that error, he says, historians must try to avoid. So the point I try to make then in my paper is that Islam is vested in civil society, in the Ummah, not in the caliphate. Mansa Musa of Mali never created a caliphate, never went on the jihad to create a caliphate. Mansa Musa was succeeded by Songhai, the Songhai Empire, whose king, Askia Muhammad Ture, also went on pilgrimage to Mecca in the 15th century. Very interesting man. His principal advisor in Gao, his capital, his principal advisor was Al-Maghili, the Machiavelli of his day, who was very militant and tried to bring a kind of militant doctrine of warfare for the expansion of Islam. Askia Muhammad ignored him completely. He went to Mecca, he was a very devout Muslim. He asked to be recognized as the Khalifa of Western Sudan. And the person initiating him said, well, to do that, you must lay down your authority as king. So for 3 days, he was kingless. He was without his authority. And during that time, he was initiated into being the office holder of Islam in West Africa. When he came back, he never went on jihad once, except perhaps against the Mossi in a skirmish, political boundary dispute. But Askia Muhammad never imposed Islam on his subjects, and he never imposed Islam even on his court. Now, these historical examples are outstanding, but we know one of the most outstanding examples of this peaceful process in Islam is the creation of religious asylums or sanctuaries, the most famous of which surely is Timbuktu, a city of divines, a city of learning, a city of scholarship. My colleague and friend Usman Khan has just come out with a book called Beyond Timbuktu, Intellectual History of Muslim West Africa. Timbuktu was a sanctuary from politics. The king of Songhai was never allowed to enter the city except once in a year during Ramadan, actually the Laylatul Qadr, the night of Pahd, 27th Ramadan, when the king came as a supplicant, begging, asking for the prayers of Quran school students. And he went on his knees. He had a skirmish, he had a conflict with the scholars of Timbuktu. And he challenged the scholars. He said, well, I've sent my messengers to you, you turned them away. Can you give me a justification for disobeying my orders? They summoned him. He came to court. And one of the scholars said to him, maybe you are forgotten, but when you were made king, you came to ask for our prayers to place ourselves between you and hellfire. And in doing that, you actually went on your knees and you crawled up to us. And we held you steady so you could rise on your feet. Have you forgotten that? By God, said the king, I have. And apologized profusely and begged for the scholars to continue to pray for him. Another ruler, Askia Daoud, heard that the Sankore Mosque, the great mosque of Timbuktu, was being built. He sent a donation. He was very cross. He was angry that they didn't tell him they were going to do this reconstruction of the mosque. And so he sent a donation. The scholars did not refuse the donation, but they refused to use it for the mosque. They sent a message to the king to thank him for his donation and said, we have used your donation for repairs to the Muslim cemetery, not for building the mosque. There were other centers. Jaha Bambuku is one of those centers, which was an asylum from politics. Another center in Senegal, this is really going back to the 15th century, Gunjur, was an asylum from politics. The point I want to make with these examples is to argue that at least in West African Islam, and I would say generally in the Islamic intellectual tradition, there is a recognition of the distinction between religion and politics. It is there. Proof for classical Islam, look at the Sharia. Right? Malik, Shafi, Hanafi, Hanbal. All of them were persecuted by political authorities. None of them was an employee of the caliphate. You know what happened to Abu Hanifa in Baghdad? He was arrested, placed in a dungeon, beaten, he was bleeding on the authority of the rulers. After 21 days, the ruler found out, the Sultan, that Hanafi was still alive. He sent his agents to poison him. So he died, Hanafi died. And Abu Hanifa died. And there was a mass civil disobedience on the streets of Baghdad for 3 weeks against the governor of Baghdad. Because you know what happened with Hanbal. After his death, 800,000 people turned up for his funeral. Again, an act of civil disobedience. Malik was bastinadoed, bleeding, shoulders dislocated because he refused to back down before the Sultan. And Shafi was in a dungeon in Baghdad. It was Shaibani, his student, who intervened on his behalf to have him rescued. The point I'm trying to make, and the great legal schools of Khairawan of North Africa, were all created independent of the political structures and the political rulers. So my point is that there is a distinction in Islamic history between religion and politics. It is not separation of religion and politics, it is not separation of church and state, as we have it in the West, but there's a very important distinction. And what's happened in West African Islam is that this distinction became the engine, the motive power, the momentum for the spread and expansion of Islam. So the second part of my paper is to look at those who undertook jihad, the problems they had with jihad itself, even as an Islamic concept. Dan Fodio, the arch-jihadist of West Africa, wrote a poem in the middle of the jihad operations called in Hausa, Wallahi Wallahi, in which he swore he would have nothing to do with jihad. He said, I have accepted no temporal office from jihad. When they sent him gifts and presents, he returned these gifts and presents and said, no one should send him such filth again. In his words, there is a chapter in Bayan Wujub al-Hijra on gifts and gift making that Dan Fodio wrote in the middle of the jihad. His son, Muhammad Bello, said there were, the ummah, he said, consisted of members, nine of whom are not Muslim. Many people, he said, joined the jihad because it was popular. Many people joined it for very selfish reasons. And many others joined it just because it's a Fulani jihad and they are Fulani, although they don't really care about Islam. They just want to ride the bandwagon of Fulani or kind of ethnic association. He dismissed them. Now, the person who really challenged Dan Fodio, and I want to, if I have time, give myself 10 minutes to stop, was Muhammad Al-Kanimi, who was a student who studied in Cairo and Medina, and quite a formidable scholar in his own right. And he challenged Dan Fodio and the others on the rationale and the justification for jihad. And if I have time, I want to go through his arguments. They are very relevant to how we here in North America, in the American post 9/11 culture, should be able to talk about violence and extremism in Islam. Al-Kanimi's arguments are very, very relevant and current. One of his arguments is, I have to summarize, is that to claim jihad in order to say you want to purify Islam and create a perfect Islam is a form of infidelity to Islam itself. It's being unfaithful to Islam. Why? He said, because if you say that only a pure and perfect Islam is acceptable, there is nowhere in history where you can point to that example. Therefore, you must condemn the ancestors of the faith, the forerunners of the faith, with to whom God entrusted Islam, in spite of their fallibility, in spite of their imperfection, in spite of the fact that they're human, all too human, and yet they were entrusted with Islam. So you must condemn them, because they didn't live up to the highest standards that you as a jihadist claims is really, truly the only thing that makes Islam valid. You have, by the act of jihad itself, invalidated Islam. It's a very powerful argument. The second argument he makes is that if you really believe in Islam, in jihad in Islam, then you must inaugurate an era of perpetual warfare within Islam itself. You must keep packing bullets into the gun. Keep fighting, because you will never reach that perfection in your lifetime or in the lifetime of those who come after you. So jihad means perpetual warfare within Islam. But that is not, he says, how God created the ummah. That is not God's intention for Islam. There is a third argument Al-Kanimi makes. If you really believe in jihad, the result is that you will treat fellow Muslims nearly the same as you treat unbelievers. This point was made against Danfodio. The Quran in chapter 4 says that you cannot shed the blood of a fellow Muslim. And if you do, God has an implacable enmity towards you. He says in chapter 4 of the Quran. Al-Kanimi says to Danfodio, but you've done exactly that. You come to our country, we have mosque, we pray there every Friday. When you came, your troops took over these mosques, and you continue to pray in them. But they are not temples, they are not pagan shrines. So that fact alone shows you that there were Muslims already here before you came. But you treated them as unbelievers. So the point I'm trying to make here is that there is an internal debate and dialogue that Muslims have carried on within Islam long before the modern West on the basis of Islamic principles, that Islam itself is the remedy for extremism. Extremism cannot be remedied by so-called democratic principles. Extremism, as Benjamin was saying in his lecture, is really a function of the complete severance from the spiritual and intellectual heritage of Islam. The final part of my paper, I am timing myself because I want to show you this little clip, musical clip from YouTube, is to say that in North Nigeria, there was a big debate which clarified for us the fundamental problem at stake in modern Islam. The debate in North Nigeria was between the Islamization of the state, or the politicization of Islam, and the Islamization of society. What is the distinction? What is the difference? I want to quote a quip from Sufyan Thawri, a jurist from very early Islam. He died in 772. By the way, this advice was picked up in West Africa in the jihad of Al-Hajj Umar al-Futi that Benjamin referred to, and also even before then, Ahmad al-Bakai in his confrontation with Al-Hajj Umar. Sufyan Thawri's statement is that the best rulers of the world are those who visit religious scholars. The worst religious scholars are those who visit worldly rulers. It's a very perceptive and a very deceptively simple statement of a profound principle. And that principle is that when politics, political calculations, qualify the moral life, religion, then politics becomes tyrannical and religion is corrupted. But when moral principles, in this case, your fidelity to God, the Islamic takbir, Allahu Akbar, God than whom is nothing greater, if you modify that and qualify that by saying, well, but sometimes the state is greater or the political ruler is more powerful, then Sufyan Thawri says, you actually destroy the moral foundation of religion, which is enshrined in the conscience, and you also corrupt politics because politics will then adorn itself with the mantle of religion. And I translate it in this way, that if you absolutize the relative, you must relativize the absolute. It's a wonderful musical piece, Tumani Jebate from Mali, that I listened to even coming here. There's a statement in it by a musician who says in the lyrics, only truth is worthy of itself. Only truth is worthy of itself. And I thought to myself when it first struck me, this is exactly the translation of Allahu Akbar. Only God is worthy of God. The ruler cannot substitute for God. That's a wonderful, I like stories, I'm an historian, and a wonderful story of the teacher of Ahmed, the son of Hulagu Khan, the grandson of Genghis Khan, the Mongols who invaded Baghdad in the 13th century and toppled the Abbasid Caliphate. I came across this recently in the tafsir of Baydawi, the Anwar al-Tanzil, the Lights of Revelation. It's a wonderful little piece. The teacher of Ahmed, this Mongol ruler of Baghdad, sent a letter to him to say, I want to recommend a great scholar for you to appoint as judge. The way he couched the appeal was, for me, very instructive. He said, Your Lordship, I have a great scholar who wants with you a share of hell. I mean, he requests the appointment of a judgeship the length of a prayer rug in the fire. I thought this is a remarkable statement coming from this scholar. He's not kowtowing before political rulers. He's not currying favor. He's not trying to play to this man's ego. You have so much power. You are the son of the greatest conqueror of the world, and so forth and so on. Nothing of that. Rather, to remind him that political sovereignty is always subject to the sovereignty of God, and that in the final analysis, there is an ethical obligation that no one, whatever their rank in society, whatever their position, can be absolved from, and that is accountability to God. What the Quran itself calls divine, human answerability, to be answerable to God. And I think that anecdote for me, occurring in the context of the Mongol power structure, really does clinch the very important distinction scholars had in mind between religion and politics. The one is superior and the other is relative. But Muslim thought, Al-Ghazali and others, believes that anarchy is not, again, God's intention for us. Right? Al-Mawadi makes this into almost a divine principle. But God wants order for human society. And so my final comment on this tradition then is to say that civil society becomes the safeguard for a pluralist, inclusive, democratic society, because the Islamization of society allows space for other groups to propagate their own ideas, their own views, rather than the Islamization of the state with the politicization of religion. In the United States, we have made a horrible mess of this, in spite of the warning of James Madison and others. Tocqueville in Democracy in America picks this up, that we in America have forgotten the distinction between being a citizen, proud, strong, political, but also being subject to the ruler of the universe, who is God. And I believe this distinction West African Islam has picked up, nourished, propagated, promoted, and in Senegal it has been the basis for a vibrant, admirable form of democratic participation in life and politics. I have about 5 minutes that I want to turn to this clip. It is relevant to peace. The musician comes from Casamance, southern Senegal. The accompanist is Elika Frizell from, I believe, Sweden, Swedish violinist. And they have come together to play on the theme of peace. And I am completely a consumer in music, not a producer of it. But this, for me, is an example of what Benjamin was talking about, this essential Islamic humanism in West Africa that has been, I think, little understood in the West. So I'm going to I can, yes, okay. I'm going to play this and someone else will control the volume.
We'll be right back. Karafa Alama Kumbaran Karafa Alanga La Chila Mara Jenea Balimang Alalong Baran Karafa Karamu Sikuba Makanka Krishna
Thank you very much, Professor Sanneh. If I may begin with the first question, just to get things started, I appreciate your point about the interactions and interfaces between church and state, but the distinction between religion and politics. And I found your the saying that you brought up, the best of rulers is one that visits scholars and visits being sort of an act of honor, and the worst of scholars being he who visits rulers. And in that vein, we have, for example, in Baghdad, Seljuk Baghdad, the Nizamiya as a madrasa as established by Nizam al-Mulk, again, as a way of honoring the ulama. And in Cairo, you have the Mansuriya during the Mamluk era, again, established by Mansur Qalun as a way of honoring the profession of the ulama and the madrasa as an institution, which actually plays a much bigger role. The madrasa plays a much bigger role in Islamic culture than does any mosque or church. But I'm wondering, what are parallels that you see in West Africa in terms of ways in which rulers have honored the profession of the ulama or the institution of the madrasa? What are examples that you have run across?
Yeah, it's a very interesting question. The Jahanka have typically refused subsidies by the state or the government, including sponsorship by political rulers. Mm-hmm. Typically refused it. This is... this continues to this day. When the King of Saudi Arabia was visiting Senegal, Dakar, the president summoned the Maliki Mufti, who was based in Casamance, whom I interviewed, a Jahanka scholar. And the Maliki Mufti, Muhammad Fode, refused. He said, no, that's not my... my kind of thing, and I wish him all the best on his visit, but I really have very little to say or to do. And he wouldn't come until the president assured him that he would be meeting a Muslim guest, not so much a ruler or a king, but a Muslim guest to the country, and that a man of his learning, of his eminence and stature, be a great honor for Senegal to be able to include him in the delegation to receive the king, and how he relented. Eventually went to meet the king, but came back. I visited his home, which is very difficult to access. It's still there, but you have to cross a ferry in the Sungurgu River to get to his home and visit him there. He's refused to have a base in Dakar, although he's the Maliki Mufti of Senegal. The same thing with Senghor and Sekou Touré. They together went to visit the clerics in Senegal Oriental, Maka Kolibantan, and Sekou Touré appealed to the clerics, please, to return to Guinea, which they left shortly before independence, and the clerics refused. Mm-hmm. Now, it's very interesting. The clerics didn't go to Dakar to meet the president. The president came to Maka Kolibantan to meet the clerics. It's a very, very interesting dynamic. So they refused to have any kind of sponsorship by political rulers. Mm-hmm. But political rulers have visited these centers to pay them homage. Mm-hmm. And I think that's probably a very safe thing to do. In my own work, for example, at Yale, I run a number of projects. And I remember one particular project, the president of Yale said he wanted to support this work. It's a really colloquia of scholars across different parts of the world. We meet once a year in Edinburgh and at Yale, and we don't have any money, we have no budget. Everyone comes under our own steam, and the president said he was happy to provide a budget for these annual meetings. And I said, thank you, but no thank you. And the reason, again, I'm inspired by the clerics here, is that if there is a squeeze, if there is a budgetary squeeze, we will be the first to go. By which time, we would have been so dependent on subsidies from the central administration that withdrawal of that support would have killed the organization. So we met more than nearly 25 years now, every year, with no budget. We have no offices, you know, very democratic. Graduate students, professors, senior scholars, they come and sit around a round table. Everyone has 20 minutes. Everyone is treated the same. We had 12 people when we first met. We thought, well, we'll meet for 3 years. We've been meeting for 25 years, and the list has grown to over 700 scholars spread across the world. We have no budget, no subsidy. The clerics taught me something.
Any questions?
The audience?
I don't think I need a mic.
We need a mic because I think it's being recorded.
Oh, okay. Well, maybe I might not want to ask my question now. thank you, Professor Sanneh. You know, one of the things that between your talk and part of Butch Ware's talk this morning, I'm just thinking out loud, and I'd just like to get your feedback on these ruminations. With regard to the relationship between the, let's call it the religious establishment or the clerical class, and the state in pre-modern times compared to modern times, mm-hmm. How much of a differential would you say there is, or what is the significance, the weight of the differential between the weak states of the pre-modern era and the strong states of the modern era? And by weak and strong, I have in mind something that Sammy Huntington talks about with regard to how sort of pre-modern states are shaped like a sort of a U, where you have family and sort of religious association or whatever as the apex sort of nodes with which one identifies with, and the state sort of in the valley. Mm-hmm. I mean, the last entity you turn to virtually for anything, almost as if it exists as a necessary evil almost, mm-hmm. As compared to the modern state where, you know, family and even religious and professional association, they're down here and the state is at the apex. Mm-hmm. Enjoying that kind of power, mm-hmm. that kind of monopoly of resources, mm-hmm. That kind of monopoly of legitimacy in terms of the right to use that power. Mm-hmm. How can the pre-modern arrangement where ulama just stay away from power, mm-hmm. don't seek to moralize it, mm-hmm. how sustainable is that in a modern context? And is that not running the risk of producing the very kind of sort of extremist movements mm-hmm. as a last ditch sort of desperate effort to rein this monster in, as it were? Mm-hmm. Just your reflections on that.
Yeah. Well, the British confronted this question of the pre-modern and the modern in North Nigeria. It's a very good example where you can actually study these two forms of political association. And Mori Last and Muhammad Al-Haj had an article published in Africa a long time ago exploring this very question of the position of the ulema vis-a-vis the modern state. I wish I can just recall the title of the article, Mori Last and Muhammad Al-Haj, and where they demonstrate that the ulema, who were bureaucrats, they are employed as bureaucrats by the colonial system, nevertheless found a way to keep their moral distance from the colonial state. And it worked a little bit because the British were flexible. They didn't insist in the French style of imposing a top-heavy state, top-down, but were quite prepared to be pragmatic. Almost. But the scholars still wanted to keep their distance from the political rulers. I think one of the great challenges we face is the decline, the collapse of the secular nation state, which was imposed on the Muslim world after colonial rule. And I am very concerned that even as scholars, we expect Islam as a religious institution to solve the political problems bequeathed by the failure of the secular nation state. For example, extremism is a very good example of that. We say, why are Muslims not solving the problem of extremism? And Muslim scholars, like the rest of us, absorb this criticism, internalize it, and then they turn on Islam and say, yeah, Islam has failed. In fact, there's because we're being recorded, I can't I can't give this name, but a prominent North American scholar of Islam had quite a famous university lecture called The Political Failure of Islam. The political failures of Muslim countries are political failures, they are not religious failures. Political disenchantment in the Muslim world is not reflected in religious disenchantment among Muslims. The mosques are not emptying out because of political disarray and political collapse. You see what I'm trying to say? So I just think that we need to recover a kind of intellectual initiative, rather than being on the defensive all the time, to say, let us not impose on Islam the problems from the political sphere, the failure of the state to deliver on economic justice, the failure of the state to deliver justice, law and order for ordinary citizens, the failure of the state to account for revenue it gets from the people. Let's not impose these problems on Islam. it's not really, for me, it doesn't make intellectual sense. It doesn't make logical sense. And the only way I feel I want to get at this problem now is to insist on the distinction, which is there in religious thought in Islam, between religion and politics. The fundamental distinction. Then we can hold political rulers accountable for the political failures in Muslim societies and Muslim countries. Rather than Islam, Muslims beating themselves over the head because of the mismanagement and the rascals they have as their political leaders. By the way, I have shared many of these ideas with my Arab friends in the Muslim world. In Egypt, at a major conference, Al-Azhar, I spoke about some of these ideas. Saudi Arabia, where I was honored to be invited by the government. I shared some of these ideas. My book, Beyond Jihad, has been introduced to the leadership there. So I try to speak about these fundamental questions that really Muslims should not be the only ones to have to answer.
So you brought up Saudi Arabia. I'm also thinking about states like Iran and also Saudi Arabia as well, because those are states that have not only not made a distinction between religion and politics.
Can you speak up a little bit?
Yeah, but have equated the two in terms of sort of that almost top-heavy model that you were talking about. So I guess my question is, what are our obligations as American Western Muslims in a calling out the associations made between religion and politics by the very religious political leaders of those nations, and as a community that has a growing, young generation of critically minded Muslim thinkers, people who are going to American universities, to Western universities to learn about Islam, what are our own obligations in entering the political sphere and our own obligations with interacting with the politics of our nation?
It's an excellent question. We don't have more time at our disposal, but we are very fortunate in the United States that we have a strong, vibrant culture of civil society. We have that in the United States. It is less so in Europe. When I speak to my European colleagues in Europe, in Denmark, in Sweden, in Holland, Netherlands, and Germany, they say, but we've lost that. They don't really have a very strong sense of civil society. We have that in the United States, a very strong sense of civil society. Muslims have a lot to contribute to the culture of civil society. That's exactly what I'm saying about the Ummah. I don't have time to develop this, but there's a short article in the Encyclopedia of Islam on the Ummah, showing in a very neat way how the Ummah was first an Arab tribe, as it were. Membership was exclusive, almost like an Arab tribal cabal. When the Prophet took over the Ummah, he tried to broaden it so that the Ummah ceased to be an exclusive Arab club under the Prophet's leadership. Then it became, also non-Muslims became members of the Ummah. But to make this distinction between religion and politics, the Ummah rapidly became an association of Muslims under the authority of the Prophet, centered in worship of God. This is so critical, so that you didn't need a caliph to be head of the Ummah. The Ummah's head is God, and therefore the Prophet, by that function, becomes the head of a faith community that transcends national boundaries, racial boundaries, geographical boundaries, even temporal boundaries. This Ummah is a civil society institution. It is civil society. And Muslims here, I have my good friend at Yale, the Muslim chaplain, Omar Bajwa. I'd ask him to speak to Divinity School students, and he tells the story of how when Muslims come to Yale as students from different parts of the world, as well as from the United States, he never has to convene a meeting about group process. Oh, you come from different cultures, you come from different backgrounds, we should all try and forget our differences, we should all try. He said, no, he don't have to do that. That work has already been done for him by the power of the Ummah. Umar never has to worry about whether culture was going to get in the way of these Muslims. So I'm saying you have the opportunity, we have the opportunity to develop the civil society aspect of Islam in the United States in a way that is strong, that can account for itself, that can seize the initiative, that doesn't have to be defensive, that can hold political rulers accountable. That's your duty as a Muslim.
Question? just a short question. Don't you feel that we as Muslims wasted 30 years or 40 years? Because when we immigrated to this country, we were educated. You know, we didn't have to dig the ground or... I came as a physician. We wasted 30, 40 years of our time. Of course, we put in the masjids and other sort of things related to the mosque and religious studies and all that. We did that. But we never came out of the masjid.
Mm-hmm.
We never came out to tell who we were.
Mm-hmm.
And the most affluent, educated Muslims in this world are living in the United States.
Yeah.
We are 1% population here, and we are 10% physicians in this country. Don't you feel sad that we wasted all this time?
I hope not wasted it, but I also hope you recognize how much richer America would be without Muslim input. I was at the Library of Congress for meetings that coincided with the retirement of the Librarian of Congress. And they made the point that the Library of Congress was created to bring Greece to Rome, right? In other words, to bring knowledge and intellectual power to the center of political power. And the Library of Congress is America's way of bringing in knowledge from all parts of the world into America so that policymakers, our political leaders, can be wisely guided in making policy. And my addition to that, drawing from my understanding of Islamic history, is that, and then the joke is that Rome was never more itself than when it borrowed from the Greeks. A classical scholar put it like that. Rome was never more itself than when it borrowed from the Greeks. And you can say America was never more itself than when it borrowed from the other cultural traditions of the world. America was, and this is true for America as an immigrant nation. And so instead of Muslims feeling defensive, this is your country in a kind of original historical sense of the word. Benjamin Franklin acknowledged this. Thomas Jefferson acknowledged this. John Adams acknowledged this in his Thoughts on Government. This is the first country to recognize the United States as a country in 1777 was Morocco, an African Muslim country. So in a sense, Muslims belong to America in terms of the logic of America itself, in terms of its ideology as an immigrant nation. And I believe me, I want to join you in giving voice to that idea of America, because I think America is the beneficiary of that vision of America. It's not just Muslims gaining something for themselves. It's actually, America is an errand, the Harvard historian of the Puritan, Perry Miller, put it. America is an errand. The journey is not, it's just been joined, it's not finished. And in that journey, Muslims have a tremendous amount to contribute. From my own little, believe me, I know very little about this vast intellectual tradition that is Islam, but the little I know about it convinces me that time is not wasted. No, you haven't wasted 30 years.
Thank you all for joining us here today.